Welcome to a new test and teardown video. This time it's an B and O, Bang and Olufsen, K3 Distortion Meter, DM1. It is not a distortion meter in the classic understanding, so it's not a total harmonic distortion or anything like that. And that is what I first thought it would be, and that I could use it for all sorts of cool things, but that is not the case. This unit is specially made for tape recorders. So, let me show you a block diagram of this unit. On the block diagram, you see a signal generator here in the bottom middle part of the block diagram. So this signal generator can be either 333 hertz or it could be 1 kilohertz depending on the different modes of the front panel. So K3, that means the third harmonic test. So the idea is this unit generates a 333 hertz test signal. You record this on your tape recorder, and if your tape recorder is correctly aligned and set up for the correct drive levels and all those kind of things, then your playback will also be a very nice and clean signal. Otherwise, it will generate a lot of harmonics, and the harmonics will be 1 kilohertz. So this system here consists of a 1 kilohertz bandpass filter, and that is explained here in the middle of the schematic. And then you have attenuators where you can set up the different sensitivity that is just done on the output of the filter. And then we got detection and meter drive. But you also have an AC amplifier that goes to the output so you can drive something external. On the bottom of the unit we have a little switch here, and this changes the output of the oscillator if it's low or high level. Output is driving directly the two left and right outputs of the DIN connector. The DIN is a stereo input, stereo output connector, and this goes directly into tape recorders, so that it is that simple. You can, on this unit, test left or right channel separately by switching here. I only have a 3-pin DIN connector, and you need to plug in a DIN connector because there is a little hidden switch. I don't know if you can see, there's a little black plastic part. No, but there is a little switch here, and this switch, funny enough, shorts the input of this unit, so you can't really just stick in some wires or anything like that. It's not working like that. Let's see here on the back, we got the AC output, or we got the drive output, and we also got a DC output, the meter drive. And the funny thing is, Bang & Olufsen, they're mostly known by their audio hi-fi line of equipment, but they also have a great line of all sorts of instruments for laboratories. And of course, most of these instruments, they are related to audio instrument testing and so forth. Yeah, let's try and see if we can play with this. Look at the way the oscillator warms up. So this is a Wien bridge oscillator made by an op amp and a little bulb. I will of course show you this on the schematic. So let's just put in a little snip from the schematic so you can see this oscillator, and of course this is why it takes so long. The bulb and the drive and the feedback here, and this is a good thing. The longer it takes for the oscillator to swing in, so to speak, it's probably much more stable on the harmonics. So I should definitely measure the output. harmonic. So this is 997 hertz, and this is the reference. And there's also a, I don't know if you can read the text down below here. Yes, can you do that now? It says erasure. So this is not the pop band, but this is the tape erasure test. And if you hit in the erasure test, it kills the signal generator, and then it's aligning the test for 1 kilohertz, and then you can now measure the level of 1 kilohertz remaining from the previous recording. So the idea is you enable your reference and record, I don't know how many minutes you need, right? And then rewind, erase, and then check, is it really erased? And then it will be able to detect any tiny bits left of this 1 kilohertz. So in K3 mode, it is, yeah, after a little bit of unstable. Look at that. This is just amazing, isn't it? So here is 32.5. So it's amazingly accurate, the oscillator frequency. So yeah, again, we set up here, it's yeah, showing the levels on the meter and all that. And here is the idea of generation of that frequency. Oh, as you can see here, I have a little bit of problem with my, so it is like that. Okay, so what I wanted to show you is the meter indication here, and now I am in K3 test, and that is, of course, it's generating the 333 hertz signal, and then it is testing for the harmonics in real time. You can do that in real time, or you can also do it on a recording. So I am in 15% full range, and I will of course turn on my signal oscillator. I have an external oscillator connected here, and my reference signal is 1 volt peak. And of course I can lower that input voltage until you see a drop on the meter. Is it really working? So this is 10 millivolts, you see? So that is a lot. And this is, of course, and then I can crank it up. So yeah, 15 here is 11 millivolts peak in relation to 1 volt peak. So it is, it needs to be really weak. And I think it is the scale that you need to use in K3 mode. That is probably the 50 dB, isn't it, right? And then we can go to 5% full range, but I think it is 60 dB, right? And then I go down again, all the way down. Yes, here you go. So this just shows you how crazy sensitive it is. And this is at 1 kilohertz, where the filter is very, very sensitive. So what about I go to the 1 kilohertz, and then I go for the 100, and then I crank up. Yes, see, this is 1100, and then I go back to 1000, and then down to 900. So this shows you the filter. So that is 900, 800, 700, and then the signal is, of course, gone. And the way that they made this filter, I should, of course, show you the schematic of the whole unit. And as you can see here on the schematic, this is a very modern design, full of op amps and all the fancy gizmos. The filter, and that is the interesting part, I think, really, is 3 op amp band pass filters. And the first one is set for 1000 hertz. The next one is set for a frequency a little bit under, and the last one is set for a frequency a little bit over. And this is done intentionally to make the top of the filter flat, and then very, very steep edges. So that is how you need to do that. If you had three filters after each other with exactly the same frequency, you would have a very, very small, narrow top. And then it would be impossible to have the needed accuracy of the oscillator to hit that spot. So that is why they made the top a little bit flat and a little bit wider. Yeah, for accuracy, of course.
I am having some sort of a nasty fight to get this unit out of the case. And this is, of course, because this is a classic problem with these B&O cases. And you can see that this one is nicely painted to make it look nice and fine again. They are made of a type of iron steel that really corrode and rust really, really bad. And especially if they have been stored in a humid shed or something like that for many, many years. The original color looks a little bit like this special kind of light blue. And this one was definitely painted to make it look nice and fine again. But unfortunately, this paint also added a little bit of space up here. So it was also painted on the inside. And you can even see there's some nasty corrosion damage even through here. But anyway, the thing is, due to the paint, I can't get the unit all the way, see, and all the way in here. And this is needed to make this cover go this way. So I need to push it really, really hard while holding the cover like that. So if you decide to paint these one day, please only do it on the outside when they have a design like this. Otherwise, there is no way to get it in or out without damaging the new paint. And this is causing all sorts of pain. Just saying, look at that. I don't know how to do this without getting hurt. Well, meanwhile, we can enjoy the bottom of this really, really nice PCB. It is coated, and that is nice for humidity and anti-corrosion handling. Great with a big thick layer of varnish. I love that. I really recommend coating your designs. Let's look a little bit on the inside here. If we look here, this is the input. First, there is this input op amp right there, right? And then we got TR1 and TR2. That will be two field effect transistors. How about that? And then we go to the next op amp. But that one is also interesting. Look at that part. This is called R66, and then there's a little LED and an LDR. So this is for level control. So there's a built-in compressor limiter, optically controlled limiter. That is something, huh? And then, yes, some more field effect transistors, and that will be the oscillator. So here's the bulb and the op amp for the oscillator. And by the way, those red capacitors you see here all over the place, they are famous for failing. But I don't see any cracks in any of these. It's like the casing is some sort of a funny Bakelite kind of. They are from the 70s or some
80s probably also there. This unit is quite old. But they, those are definitely what I recommend to change. Look at this nice shielding. I don't know if this is originally done like that. See, this is the AC output. It comes down from the connector, and that is of course a shielded cable. And as you can understand, this one is isolated from chassis, so there's no current going in that shielded cable, and it is somehow shielded together with mains. I don't like that really. I think it's a good idea to shield mains, but I don't think it's a good idea to shield your sensitive signals together with mains. Why would you do that? So that is, I don't know, a misunderstood fix somehow. I don't like that. If the mains was a problem, why was you could just kind of bypass the switch and just have it directly here, right? And then, or have a switch here at the back. I kind of don't like that. And also there's another little design problem. If you see the screw here, see the length of that screw that goes, I mean, this is a thin isolation material, but when this plastic rubber stuff goes into, I don't know what it goes into, it goes, well, you need to tighten the screw a little bit more and more, right? And then you can imagine the screw will eventually break through this, and then you have chassis directly connected to mains. This is the mains fuse. Genius placement of that screw. They should of course have used shorter screws. But here's the fun thing. This one is longer and this one is shorter. So maybe we got a longer, shorter screw. Longer screw. So somebody disassembled this unit and assembled it back again using the wrong length of screw. Why use different length instead of just using the same four short ones? That is funny, isn't it? This also looks like a repair. Oh yeah, by the way, look at the IC date code, 79. So this unit is from 79. Yeah, it's the same on this date code. Here we got the two voltage regulators. It's running on plus minus 15 volts. And those are of course, yeah, they didn't even try to thermally connect these down to the metal down here or something like that. So I guess they're not running real warm or anything, because this unit is not using a lot of power. Let's look a little bit on the temperatures. Look at that. So that will be the two TL084 quad op amps, and they're running at 42 Celsius. And this one is, yeah, 43. Power supplies is, yeah, 40 Celsius as well. And I kind of just turned this unit on. This is 5-6 minutes or something like that. Not really a lot. That would be the rectifier, that one. I don't see any heat in any of the capacitors. They're quite cold. And that is a very good test as well, by the way. Nothing gets warmer than that. And that is, of course, because we are running the op amps at plus minus 15 volts, and they are designed for 40 volts maximum. So this is quite all right, but yeah, they run a little bit warm. So that is all I wanted to show you guys. Thank you very much for watching. Bye bye.